Thank you, Barbara. I want to welcome everyone this morning in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, to a time of worship. And as we begin our time of worship, let us join in the call to worship as it's printed in your bulletin. It is basically the 23rd Psalm with the New Revised Standard Version, with a couple of alternate phrases that brings it maybe more into what we are used to saying in the Old King James. So let us join together. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul.
He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil.
For you are with me, your rod and your staff.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Let us join now in hymn number 140, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Like a
Amen. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me and to all of us. Now we turn to our time for the choir to share their gifts with us. All glory belongs to Jesus.
We each could tell
Thank you, choir, for that beautiful presentation this morning. Let us turn now to a time of prayer as we join in the congregational prayer as it is printed in our bulletin today, saying together, O Lord our God, we want to know you. We want to know that you are our God and that you love us even in our questioning and doubt. O Lord, you have shown us your love through your Son Jesus. So help us believe in his witness to your love and power. He walked among your people and among your enemies, and his witness never wavered, his power never withdrawn from those who needed a touch from heaven. Jesus taught of your love and backed it up with demonstrations of the power of love to conquer the world's problems. He healed the diseased and infirm. He raised the dead. He fed the multitudes. He conquered the elements of wind and waves we never thought we'd see overcome. And seeing all that in real time, your people still rejected you. Your enemies rejoiced in the death of your son. Yet you redeem your people even to this day and embrace those who have faith in your grace and love. O Lord, raise us to more and even more faith, to embrace you in our hearts and live your life through our daily routines. Make us worthy, O Lord, to be your people and live as Jesus lived, as in his name we pray today. Amen. Give us peace forever. Let us continue on in prayer. And I would invite you to share any concerns that you would like to add to our list today, or share any joys that you have heard in answered prayer from our list, or not.
Yes.
Yes.
Last week I asked for prayers for my friend Lee,
yes,
who was going to have a biopsy, and it looks like, at least preliminarily, it is not cancer.
Not
so
cancer.
Final word on Thursday.
All right. Well, we'll put an exclamation point and a question mark on that. Okay, yes, sure.
I'm not sure I'm a week late or a dollar short. Maybe both. Dennis claims why Shannon's having a hip replacement. I think it's tomorrow. I don't think it was last week. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sharon, definitely keep Sharon in your prayers for a hip replacement. And Lori, I think I saw next.
I just want to have everyone keep Kathy's father-in-law in our prayers. He is bad enough.
Mm-hmm. Kathy's father-in-law, Don Lewis, and his wife, Betty, they're battling together some possible news that's not so good, but we'll keep them in prayer. I did have a visit with them this week and brought communion for them, and they were quite appreciative, and I think they were more peaceful about what was going on when I left. So yes, definitely keep them in prayer. And Pam,
a joy. My granddaughter's oldest granddaughter's husband got promoted to captain.
Oh, captain. And,
moving to Washington State this summer.
Oh, so that's good news and bad. And what's her name?
Kayla.
Captain Kayla.
No, not Captain Kayla. Andrews.
Kayla Andrews.
No. Andrew is her husband. He's the one that's the captain.
Okay. Andrew. So that's a joy, except for the distance now.
Yeah.
Not in the service, right?
But they've been in this
country. Well, that's a good thing. Yes, Janet.
My sister Joan.
I keep Joan in prayer. She's on our list. Something new for Joan. And it has to do with the shape of her esophagus, I believe. Okay, and our neighbor Bruce, is he still in the hospital, do you know?
Yeah.
He had a fall. We have more people hitting their heads in our place. I don't know what it is. I don't know. Don't know if that's working. But that's definitely a prayer that is needed. So we have a mixture this morning of good news, bad news, and maybe news. So let's continue our time of prayer with these updates. So Lord, we do thank you that you have been with us throughout all of these days and weeks and months and years of our lives. And Lord, you have given us a heart to pray for others that are dear to us and for those that are living near to us. We have a heart of prayer for lifting up those we care about and those even that we just know about. So Lord, help us to praise you in situations that are good situations of a preliminary indication of a problem that is not cancer. So we will keep that lifted up and pray that that is indeed the case. We lift up Joan to you this morning, Janet's sister, with her esophagus that is twisted, and we ask that you would somehow give her a healing for that, that you would find a way to straighten it out and give her more access to her stomach. We ask you to bring healing to Bruce as he's recovering from his fall in the hospital. We praise you for Andrew as he's been promoted and now will be moving across country to a new station. So we praise you and thank you for the ways that you are working in the lives of those who are dedicating their lives to our service. And Lord, we just thank you and praise you always for your Son, Jesus, who is our Savior and our Lord, and indeed the one who has been here with us on the earth as your perfect representative to us. And as such, he taught his disciples how to pray. And as we follow that prayer that he taught them together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now we turn to our New Testament scripture. We're going back to the book of Acts, the story of the early church. And we're reading this morning of one of the miracles that God brought to the apostles in their service. And it's quite amazing. We think of Jesus as someone who did miracles around the area, healing the sick and raising the dead, but that power was passed on to the disciples, the apostles, as they continued to follow God through the Holy Spirit. And this is one of those times when we see that kind of miracle. This is Acts 9, verses 36 to 43. Now in Joppa, there was a disciple whose name was Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was devoted to good works and acts of charity. At that time, she became ill and died. When they had washed her, they laid her in a room upstairs. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples who heard that Peter was there sent two men to him with a request. Please come to us without delay. So Peter got up and went with them. And when he arrived, they took him to the room upstairs. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was still with them. Peter put all of them outside, and then he knelt down and prayed. He turned to the body and said, Tabitha, get up. Then she opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he showed her to be alive. This became known throughout Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. I think I might, on hearing a story like that, so close by. And meanwhile, he stayed in Joppa for some time with a certain Simon, a tanner. May we hear in these words the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God indeed. Let us turn now to our second hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand, number 474 in your hymnal. While the choir is processing back to their seats, I'm going to change the order a little bit. And I'm going to move the special music up to now. Several years ago, the Lord led me to write a song, especially for Mother's Day. And I called it, well, when I first wrote it, I think I called it All Mothers Dwell. But really the sense of the song is that all mothers dwell in the hearts of their children. So I changed it to In the Hearts of Their Children. And I wanted to share that song with you because it is a special day for those of you who are mothers and have reared children and sent them on to live their lives in the world. And even if you haven't yet sent them on, it's still a time for celebration of the life that you've lived in that respect. So I'm going to try and share the screen here. If it will come up. Hello.
Thank you.
No, hang on, I'll get it, hopefully. The share was not coming up. No, wait a minute. Maybe this is it. You want to sing it? It tells me I'm sharing, but it's not.
It's on Terry's computer. Yeah, unfortunately, she's got that box and we can't get rid of it.
You can see it.
This one. Yeah, it's a little.
It's on Terry's.
I took off the Terry's name.
No, I'm sure. I don't understand what it's not.
Come in with the speaker either.
I know. That's what I'm trying to find it. I know it's not coming up. I don't know why. I'm afraid maybe you can all gather around my screen. I just don't know why the microphone's not working. All right, I guess we'll move on. I guess I did stop the screen share. All right, sorry. You've got the words, I believe, in your bulletins. So I guess we'll move on to the gospel reading for this morning. Sorry about that. So we're going to move to the Gospel of John this morning, the 10th chapter, verses 22 through 30. Now in the 10th chapter of John, it begins by Jesus introducing himself as the gate for the sheepfold. The shepherd of the sheep who know his voice. It is a reference to his true messiahship, proof for the people of Israel that he is not an impostor, but the real thing. The people of Israel have always been looking for a Messiah, the one who will deliver them from all the problems of the world around him, the world around them. And then Jesus introduces himself further as the good shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. I know my own, he says, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Still, the people of Israel had a difficult time hearing the voice of the shepherd. And the passage we are reading from John's Gospel today is a perfect illustration of that. So beginning in verse 22, we hear these words. At that time, the festival of dedication took place in Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple, in the portico of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I have told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name testify to me. But you do not believe because you do not belong to my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. What my Father has given me is greater than all else, and no one can snatch it out of the Father's hand. The Father and I are one." May we hear in these words the gospel of the Lord. So the sermon this morning is called "Tell Us Plainly." Now Jesus had come to be in his Father's house, the rebuilt temple of God. He was there at a time when the whole nation of Israel was celebrating the rededication of the second temple, the one that replaced the original, which had been destroyed so many years before in a time of captivity. The people remembered the destruction and the rebuilding of the house of God, and Jesus was there to offer his own support for the people and their place of worship. But the people of God continued to question the true identity of the Lord Jesus as the Messiah of God, the one who would deliver them from their present slavery under Rome. They recognized who walked among them, and their questions demanded an answer. So they were very direct in their question to Jesus. "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly. Now the question had come after they had already witnessed all the miracles that surrounded Jesus in his travels. All the teaching he had given about him being the gate of the sheep, and so recently at that. He had compared the people of Israel to sheep that followed the voice of the shepherd, yet now had somehow lost their sensitivity to that voice. He plainly spoke in all his teachings about being the only way to God. And just ever so recently, about being the keeper who guarded the gate of the sheepfold. He had not hidden anything from the people, except by the telling of parables instead of direct exposition to everyone, as he plainly spoke to his closest disciples. His closest friends heard the explanation of the stories to the people, so perhaps they were in a better position to hear the answer to the people's questions of the day. Now, the stories Jesus told to God's people were stories with a message, with a lesson to be learned if they just thought about it for a moment. But these did not want to take the time to discern those tales, to find the meaning in them. To them, Jesus was an enigma, a puzzle they could not put together. They saw what he did, but they could not connect the dots with his true identity. He walked and lived among them, a man of mystery, claiming to be Messiah in kind of a hidden way to them. They could see a difference from all others in this man, but they were reluctant to believe that a mere man could be the promised Messiah of Israel, the powerful king that would either deliver them and rule over their enemies with an iron hand, and at the same time rule over them with benevolence and justice. They just could not see the promised king in the body of this gentle man. He had no white steed or iron spear, no sword of steel with which to wipe away their enemies. They just couldn't see it. So they questioned him directly. Just tell us plainly if you are the Messiah. And Jesus answered them, I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name testify to me, but you do not believe, because you do not belong to my sheep. How could I be more plain? He was telling them. You've seen the miracles that flow from God as I go around these hills and plains of Israel. Have you seen them anywhere else? Has anyone else been able to do what I do? Only God could be the source of all you have seen in me. Yet you are still blind. You still refuse to see. You still cannot hear the voice of God in mine. And Jesus gets real with them as he says, you do not believe because you do not belong to my sheep. It is as if he's telling them, you do not believe because you do not belong, and I've given you everything you need to make that leap of faith to see who I am. But your hearts are hard toward your God. You have the hearts of stone your prophet Jeremiah told you about. Unmovable, unbelieving, unreceptive to the love your God holds open for you. He judges these who question very plainly, "You do not belong to my sheep." I can almost see their demeanor change at that point, from demanding to deflated. "What do you mean we are not your sheep? We are all people of God, raised in the tradition of the elders, seeking the God of our ancestors in everything we do. We live as God taught his people to live. How can you even think that we are not people of God?" I guess they understood that part of what Jesus had to say. "My sheep hear my voice," Jesus explained. "I know them, and they follow me. And that's just not the case with you. You do not follow, but question. You have neglected your faith and listened to the demands of your traditions. You are not sensitive to the voice of the Lord your God. But if you were open and listening, you could receive what I have to offer to those who are. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. What the Father has given me is greater than all else, and no one can snatch it out of the Father's hand. The Father and I are one. If you would but open your minds for a moment, you would see that your heavenly Father and the man that speaks to you are one and the same. You have seen the works that follow me, works that only God could do. If you don't believe my words, then believe my works. They speak for my authenticity. They back up what I am saying to you. If you don't believe me, you are not mine, and I am not yours. And if you won't listen to me, then you cannot hear God either, because God, the Father, and I are one." I think I can sympathize with Jesus' frustration with his people in the temple. When things seem so plain to me, and those around me not only question but reject the God I believe so greatly in, I feel just a twinge of rejection myself. How can someone disregard something that is so obvious to me? But then again, I come to Jesus with a mustard seed of faith. My belief in Jesus as my Lord and Savior, or as John says here, the shepherd of the sheep, begins by believing that it is only through him that salvation comes, and trusting that he cares for me. That is a leap that many cannot come to make, whether they are dismissive of the facts or just don't believe they apply to them, or just closed to the idea that Jesus can be big enough to encompass the whole world with his love and compassion. There is just too much for them to overcome the way they see the Lord, to connect him to themselves. Thankfully, the Lord is patient with all of us and gives us the time to ponder the truth for us. As long as we are alive in this world, we have a chance to make that leap of faith and embrace the Lord for ourselves. It is harder for some than for others, but time is on our side. Time to hear the stories, time to witness the miracles, time to see his love at work around us, and the answer prayers we so fervently send heavenward. As long as there is breath in our lungs, we have time. And then we don't. I guess you could probably say that I am a product of the gift of time and the grace of God to be here at all today. In my early 40s, I was given the gift of a series of heart attacks and given the gift of God to survive them. Though they sapped my strength for a time, God was good to help me build that strength back up to serve him until now. I don't know how many more days or years I may have left in this world, but that time when I nearly died gave me an appreciation for the brevity of life and the lack of a guarantee for any more days beyond the present one, or any more moments even beyond now. As I look back from today, I was relatively young when the physical problems hit me hard, and those problems could have been tragic. I could have left my wife a widow in an instant, and my children fatherless at a young age. But thanks to Janet's knowledge and concern, in part at least, and her interference in the emergency room, she was an instrument of God to help me be here. And it's by God's grace that I'm here now and able to urge you to make that leap of faith in your life, if you haven't already. God was good to me then, and God's desire is to be good to all who listen to his voice. Tell us plainly, Lord, so we can hear. So my question is, are you listening? We'll move on now to our time of offering as we hear some music shared by Barbara and Jeff, as if you haven't brought your offering forward yet, I would invite you to do so now as music is being shared.
Beyond my fault and saw my need.
Heavenly Father, we do thank you for those offerings that have been brought forth this morning. We thank you for the gift of acquiring them, for your gift of providing them. And we thank you for your presence with us now and evermore. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us now join in our final hymn, Majesty, number 176 in your hymnal. I'm going to try this one more time. I discovered that I'm still trying to do this.
Oh,
and walk. Whether those mothers are with us today or are looking down from heaven upon us, we are all products of their love. So let us join now in our congregational prayer for renewal, as you find it in your bulletins, as we say together, O Jesus, who rose from the grave and defeated the last enemy in our world, you gave us hope for the future, that glorious future with you in your Father's house forever. But for now, we must live in this world where we were born, forgiven of sin through you, with hope in our hearts as we are ever more conformed to your will for us. Help us to live here with one eye fixed on heaven as we lay the foundation for life evermore. We are yours, O Lord, so give us joyful hearts in the assurance of your presence, and give us grace for our ordinary lives. Lift us above the monotony of these lives we lead, and into your joyful presence as we celebrate the new life you have given us in your precious Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now may the love of God, the love of Christ his Son, and the grace and the presence of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen. Forget cheesecake downstairs. What Bill described as sin.